Rick was very ill, and I made him get out of bed, and we drove over to Matthew's house.
At night.
Lights were on. I could see in his window. Lights were on, and I started ringing the doorbell, banging on the door. Now, typically, he would have said, go away, or come to the door, invite me in. He did nothing. Mm-hmm. That was not his pattern. And so I had a pretty good sense that perhaps something catastrophic had happened.
And what time was this?
That was late on Thursday, April 4th. And so I was pretty sure that something had happened. But he had also told us that if we called the police, that he would take his life instantly. So a call to the police was an instant suicide. Mm. So I was living with that horrible, horrible choice of, do I call the police and perhaps intervene, or do I take that risk? If I call, then he instantly kills himself. So we just had to wait for a few hours. And so it was into the next day that I felt that he was not responding.
And we didn't hear anything back from him.
He didn't go to work. He
didn't
go
up
to do his workout, which he didn't miss.
Yeah.
And so I pretty much knew. And finally, when I sent the text saying, look, I'm calling the police. If you don't, just give me one word that tells me you're okay. One word, and I won't call the police.
We'll call 911,
and there was nothing. Yeah. And so we went back to the house. His house looked exactly the same. Same lights were on. We knew. By that time, we knew.
Rick, you got back to the house in the morning. You had this awful sense that he had probably taken his life. But you couldn't get inside the house. You called the police, and you were waiting.
Right.
That moment, for the both of you, must have been beyond harrowing.
We were sobbing. We were just sobbing. The day that I had feared might happen one day since he'd been born, and the day that I'd prayed would never happen, happened. And I remember as we stood in the driveway, just embracing each other and sobbing,